Sugar. I'm so happy to be here. I love your name, Sugar Gay. What's up, Sugar Gay? You just got it. You got it made with a name. I'm doing good. I'm doing good today. I'm so happy to be here with you and your audience. Thank you for inviting me. I do. I've been podcasting for, I don't know, 5 or 6 years now, and I love it. I love this platform. It's such a great way to connect with people from your studio, from your home. So I love it. I have a new podcast. It literally launched last week. We're here in November. I tried to launch it on 11/11 because I love the number 11, and it's a good manifestation day. So I was like, let's get it out, and it was a good goal line for me. So that's out and it's live. It's called The Jeweler's View, and it's anywhere you listen to podcasts. It's on Apple, Spotify, all the things. And before that, I was honored and lucky enough to host Rio Grande's podcast, Rio Grande Jewelry Supply in Albuquerque. And I worked with them for a few years as a consultant and working in education and kind of helping them zoom in on, what the students need and what you guys need out there. And so my history allowed me to work with them in that. And then I said, you know what, let's do a podcast. So we launched For the Love of Jewelers Together, which was a brand of theirs. And I went in and hosted and produced a podcast for them for 5 years. And end of last year, 2018, whatever. Anyway, now I think Mark Nelson's doing it in-house and he's fabulous. So I'm excited they're carrying that forward. And I'm doing a new show that's a little different. That was a lot of interviewing master makers, and there's 30 great episodes there. You can go back to seasons 1 through 4, and I'm the host there. And it was really fun, really a fun time. Lots of great connections there. So great platform, Sugar. I'm glad you're doing it. I guess so. We're here in our bubble, so I don't know. You tell me. It's a cool city, isn't it? Yeah. I've been in Austin since I was like 19. I think I moved here when I was about 18, 19 years old. From Houston, it was an easy migration. Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that. Yeah, cool. H-Town. Yeah, I grew up in Houston, Texas, and all of us kind of migrated over to Austin for college, the college season, I guess you would call it. And yeah, but thank you. That's so lovely to hear. I do have a huge passion and drive to teach and to help others. Well, I don't know. How do we explain this? Level the playing field a little bit and get into things that might feel scary or vulnerable or new in a way that is comfortable and, community driven instead of boxed in or holding back knowledge from one another. So creative side was born from that. And I think it was born from my desire for personal growth and also career growth, right? So I've started a school. And it became this hub for people in a bigger way than I think I could have imagined. It really did expand beyond what I thought it would. And we were really fortunate. We had so many great people come through and teach. We had Tim McCright, Mary Lee Hugh, all these just amazing, more seasoned makers, Michael Boyd, one of my favorite designers out there, and the list goes on. David Huang, I finally got him to come. It was just so cool. It was always a challenge, like, okay, who can we get next? And all these master teachers, and then also all the local teachers and makers who were here who maybe didn't have teaching experience, we would bring them in and teach them how to teach. And I'd take them in the classroom. Okay, this is your classroom. Let's own it. How do you go in? You know more than these students, and you're gonna be good, So we would train them. I had a great staff, interchanging staff throughout 14 years of this season of my life. And yeah, COVID hit, and I had to do some reflecting and close down anyway. And I was looking at my world and I said, oh my goodness, there's a next level for me here too. And we did a really good job, and I was approached to sell, and I sold the school. And I also had another school here for metalsmithing on a larger scale for where my history was more in art metals and metal sculpture in the very beginning. And I decided, well, let's start a school for that as well. So I had two schools here, Creative Side Metalworks and Creative Side Jewelry Academy. And both of them I ended up selling to other people who wanted to carry it on. So very fortunate. And that experience, Sugar, was matchable. I can't tell you how much I learned. And I don't think we realize how much we learn until we're in hindsight, till we can look back at the experience and say, really dissect it and look at, wow, there's all this knowledge in my, where did all this come from? And it's because we put in the years there. So really important, very, very important, huge part of my path and journey. And I'm super grateful for that. And thank you. I really, when you get in your bubble and you're working away, you don't always realize the effect that it's having on others. So it's really nice to hear that people gained so much from that, we might have, yeah. Right. It's a big time, it's a big commitment. Oh, I know. And troubleshooting all the new tech and implementing all the new tech. I'm in the middle of that right now myself, and it's a lot, and it's ever changing, so it keeps us on our toes. I am. Yeah. Well, which weight do you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Absolutely. Being the boss lady. Being the boss lady is not always a walk in the park. It is very challenging. And I like to think that I was good at it, but I'm sure I wasn't perfect. And, people are coming in from all different backgrounds and they have different approaches to how they work and how their brains operate and how they function well. And so, really adhering to all of those different energies. And it was a lot of women. I had a couple of guys that were great guys, that would come in and work as a tech or, a casting technician. I had a blacksmithing instructor, Matt, who was so much fun. And but they're all just so different and unique, and we're all creatives as well. So everybody had their own line going on the side, or they were aspiring to have their own line as a side hustle, right? So that was challenging. I won't lie. It was absolutely challenging. And in the face of, I don't want to get too deep into COVID because we are all kind of coming out of that experience with new insight and a new approach, so to speak. But that was the hardest thing in my life, was honestly one of the hardest things. And I've been through some hard stuff, but I know we all have. And that was one of the most challenging things, was after 14 years of really putting my heart, soul, blood, energy into this place of personal growth. It was also about jewelry making and building skill set alongside that personal growth and business growth. Having to shut it down on that day was probably one of the most devastating things. And having to tell my sweet employees, like, go home, we have to go be safe. My son had 104 fever at the time. I couldn't even go in and talk to them face to face because we all had to mask up or stay isolated. And it was awful. It was the worst thing ever. So that piece of it, I honestly don't miss, because it is so, you feel so responsible for your employees. And I mean, I loved them to death. I truly did. I thought of them all as family, which can be tricky. You have to be careful with that. There's a certain amount of distance there that they recommend that I wasn't very good at keeping. So, at the end of the day, I hope that that journey was beneficial to everybody. I think everybody that came through walked away with something, like kind of a stepping stone to their next level. And that was always the goal for the students too. So, but yeah, I am on to new things, and it's crazy because there are seasons in our life. I'm in my 40s. I'm in my mid 40s. I did all that. I started that in my mid to late 20s. And I guess so. Yeah. Well, depends on perspective, right? Yeah. My husband's twice my age, so I don't really think of myself as a baby too much, but I hang out with a lot of older generation people that I just resonate with differently. And but yeah, I really am excited to kind of do Courtney for a little bit and not be that hub, the one who's responsible for writing the checks and making sure. I mean, sugar, our overhead was insane. It was a lot to keep up with. Yeah, it wasn't even the, I bet it has. Yeah. No. So did you ever come to the new location? Because we had two. Yeah. Yep. So what happened was I started the school in a little house in East Austin. It was like 1200 square feet or less. And we took this building that used to be, I'm pretty sure it was a gas station at one point. Then I believe it was probably a like a drug den. I mean, it was bad, So we went in there and we cleaned it out and we left it kind of raw. And it was like, okay, here's my studio. So we had the space kind of set up for me to create jewelry. And I started thinking, well, there's room here for more. And so that's when the school was born. I was teaching for the Museum of Art here in Austin. They asked, approached, they found my website and they approached me and said, hey, would you like to teach? And I said, I don't know how to teach. And they said, that's okay, come on over. So I did, and I started teaching, and people seemed to resonate with me, and I really loved it. I really enjoyed it. It kind of lit me up and kept me fired up to keep creating myself. And then they said, well, we're running out of space here, and I had to set up a shop over at Laguna Gloria. This was and a beautiful space, you guys. Laguna Gloria is just magical. If you're ever in Austin, it's one of the really just places to visit. What's that? Yes, top tier, like one of the top, probably top 10 places I would suggest. And so that was lovely going over there. But we had a pull out thing, cabinet, and I had to set up the tools every day. And there was not great ventilation and things in place that we needed for jewelry making. So we ended up satelliting to my space, which eventually became Creative Side. And we started offering more and more classes, and eventually that just took over the whole space. We had two or three bedrooms in this little house, and they were all little jewelry studios that you could go in and learn. So that was kind of the mom and pop startup situation. And after 8 years of that, that's a longer story I'll have to share with you, Gay, but sugar, it was unbelievable what happened with that whole transition. But I ended up needing to move. We outgrew that space and became just the walls. We're kind of pushing at the walls, pushing at the seams. And we needed to move. So Rhonda Coriel, who's our Gentium master and instructor, had moved to Austin, started another school. I had reached out to her immediately, said, how do we work together? This is great. She does a very different niche than we were doing. And we stayed in touch. And when that happened, she had decided to move on. So I ended up taking over her location on Ben White. And it was kind of a perfect timing thing. It was this interesting, just the timing aligned. And so with that came the mailing list, came the master teachers that she knew, and that really introduced Creative Side to this explosion, a universal explosion. It was became international. And whereas before I would say it was more local with a couple of master teachers, then it became where, okay, these really elite master makers were coming in to teach. So that was a big part of our growth, and we were there for 7 more years until COVID hit. So I know, I love it. Women Jewelers Association. That was so much fun. That was such a fun event. It was. When I hadn't been, like I keep saying, I'm in my bubble because a lot of what I do is online now. I coach and I mentor makers and people who are running schools, even not just jewelry world. I also coach singers and just different creative genres. Wherever you're at, really, we work together to kind of get to the next level. What's next? And get things in focus so you're not getting pulled in a million directions, which can very easily happen to soulpreneurs, entrepreneurs. It just we. I'm sure you can relate. It's like, okay, how do I keep up with the podcast and this and that? And there's all these things that can really overwhelm you if you're not careful. So I'm lucky I get to do that and consult with companies, and it's all online. So that was such a cool day because I brought out all these old tools that I had in the shed that I'm not using and gemstones, and got to talk to the community and really connect in a different way. I miss that, honestly. I use. Well, I'm trying. And honestly, I took a little break from it. I've been take kind of I would almost call it a sabbatical if it wasn't that I was still working. But I took after I sold the school, I went into the consulting role like immediately. It was so interesting. I was literally on an airplane to go and do these things with Rio and some different places, and and recording and doing the podcast with them for the Love of Jewelers. But I social media, they launched that show, so I didn't have to really do much. I recorded here and would send them, and they would post and do the whole thing. So now I feel a little bit like I'm starting from scratch. But here's the thing about, I'm not starting from scratch. I'm starting from here, right? And that's a big one. Yeah, that's a big one. And I'm having to remind myself daily. And this is what I talk about on my podcast, is these realities of being an entrepreneur and going through the seasons and going through the chapters that we get to go through, and being okay with where we're at and accepting it so it's not hindering our growth. Like, if I know your the title of your podcast is Jewelry as a Side Hustle. I worked with so many people who were trying to make that bridge, that gap. Like, okay, how do I, or cross the bridge, how do I cross the bridge to becoming full time? And it takes a lot of devotion, and social media is just a piece of it, but it is a big piece of it. And I'm trying. I'm like, okay, what is this? How do, what's a reel? Like, literally, like, I'm learning as I go as well. So, but I'm getting there, and it's kind of fun once you get into it and make, you can make it fun. It doesn't have to be. Thanks. I know, right? The yellow pages. Do we have cell phones? Do we even have? Yes. Now that's kind of suffering, and things have just really changed everything. And I'm looking at AI like, wow. I mean, my goodness, and ChatGPT and all these tools that you can use that, they are. They really are. And I was one of the ones that was like, that freaks me out. I don't want to even, not even gonna get, look at it. I'm not gonna look, the avoidance factor. And it's the same with anything, I think, making and evolving as a jeweler as well. We need to learn the new tech. We need to learn about CAD. We at least need to know about it and know how it could apply to our specific situation, whether we utilize it or not. Yeah. Game changer. Game changer. It's so fast. You're working with a robot. And honestly, it's been like a friend. I'm like, hey, ChatGPT, I'm feeling discouraged today. I mean, it'll literally cheer you up, or it'll roast you if you ask it to roast you. Like, okay, from everything you've learned about me, ro give me a roast, And it's like, oh yeah, this, that, and the other. Oh my goodness, marketing gold. But it really is. I'm using it as an organization tool. I'm not the best organizer. I won't pretend to be the best at anything, but people thought of me as this kind of really top tier person, and because I had this school, that was prestigious. And but goodness, I really have a lot to learn. Like, I was just going for it and didn't stop. And I really attribute that to the success of the school and that, and everybody that came in and touched it. But yeah, I use it as an organizational tool. Like, okay, let me brain dump on this. And then copy paste into Chat GPT and let it kind of streamline everything. So very useful though. No, I think I've decided to treat it very kindly. I've watched Terminator 2 too many times. Like, I know, I'm very gracious. Yeah. Be kind. Yeah. Yeah. That's funny. Yeah, it's interesting. Honestly, I hate to say this too, because you're a tech writer, and I fear for some of these positions with it, because it has, for me, having employees in the past, I've had a lot of employees in the past, and this has really replaced the need for two of them, at least. It's just saving me so much time, where those are things I used to outsource or task the employees with, and task my wonderful staff with, and they always did such a great job. But this is really a game changer. So you're smart to get up on it, sugar, because it is, it's changing things. I mean, it's kind of when CAD design came into the jewelry world. It's like everybody's pretty upset. Some people, it was probably a 50-50, where the handworking and the people who've been honing these skills to get their hands to do the things, that now this computer can come in and generate an image and you print it and there you go, you know. And I have nothing, I use CAD, I work with CAD designers a lot in the jewelry that I do, but I do understand that fear, that the change, fear of change, fear of that evolution. So, but it, yeah, it's still kind of new, you know, it just became public, so and more recently, so. Oh my goodness. I am busy again and I'm loving it. I'm like, all right. I started this fitness program at the same time that I started getting my business going again, kind of the solo Courtney show that I'm talking about throughout today. But I'm working on really expanding my coaching. I don't know if I like the word coach or if people really get what the importance of is a coach of a coach is. And I mean, even coaches need coaches. It's really just I'm acting as a mentor for people who need guidance and who may not understand all the ins and outs of this industry because it's huge. It's a huge industry. It's very broad. It's probably one of the most broad craft industries in existence with there's so many things. Yeah. Primal, very primal. Yes. And that's kind of what I love about it. It's very ancient, you know, this craft is the oldest money, you know, the oldest financial builder in the creative industry. It really has been date it dates back to, you know, primal days. So I love that. I love that kind of rooted idea behind jewelry making. But so I'm working on, I still do custom design. I've always done custom design and I love it. I get to work one-on-one with people to take their idea, if it's an heirloom remake, if it's engagement ring, wedding jewelry, custom pendant, I like to call them power pieces. I'm like, let's make your power piece, like something that you can put on and just feel really strong about wearing, confident. Yeah, I mostly do. I'm mostly working gold or platinum, and if it's a larger piece, we'll integrate silver. But yeah, I'd still do that. The good news is I get to say yes and no to the things that I really want to make now. And I'm not bragging about that. I just decided, like, I'm not really wanting to make, I don't do repair. I don't, there's certain things that I just don't have, don't fit into my calendar anymore that I used to. I think when you're starting out, and you guys could probably relate, is you're saying yes to everything or you're saying no to everything because of fear, but you're saying yes to jobs because you need the income and because it's there in front of you. I better figure this out. And a lot of times what happens is we say yes to things that aren't cover, they're not in our budget. They don't have the budget for this. So we end up selling our work at a lower value than it actually is. And a lot of times just breaking even, which breaks my heart for people because, you know, yeah, it is real. That's a real struggle. And I'm no stranger to that. I started charging more for my works in slow steps and now I keep a minimum and I can't say yes to things under that minimum. It's just a principle that I've had to set. And it takes a lot of time to make work that we do. It's a meticulous, the learning time, the, you know, expanding your skill set time, the tool investment, the materials, all of these things have to be accounted for. Sourcing. Totally. And it's overwhelming. So the good news of what part of what I'm working on is I'm creating an online course for people who are need to have these answers and need the resources and don't know how to get them. We can Google things all day and search and chat GPT, but there's a lot out there. So my goal is to condense it into a course, probably a 6-week course. I'm working on it now for the new year in 2025, and I'm going to launch it to those who are already in the industry and want clarification or guidance. So it's going to allow me, or those who are starting up or maybe have it as a side hustle who want to take it to full time or more full time. Yeah, I'm excited. Oh, Instagram. Yeah, for sure. Courtney Gray. I mean, you can Google Courtney Gray. I think a stripper comes up in Dallas. So maybe dig a little deeper. No, she used to. There's a few other coaches out there named Courtney Gray, actually. But Courtney Gray Arts is my website. And that's probably the best way to stay in touch with all the things that I'm doing right now and see some of the custom work I've done in the past, or just reach out and say hi. Hi at Courtney Gray Arts is my email. And I want to hear from people right now because, again, I'm building this for you. I'm building this for those who haven't had the fortune of being in this for 25 years and need a little guidance and need a little support and mindset support, et cetera. So that's my goal. And the Jeweler's View, it's out. I'll be doing a podcast every week. I've committed to every week, which is totally nuts, and I'm totally jazzed about it. So there's short ones, like you could do it on your walk, you could do it in your car drive to work, pick up the kids, whatever works. And that's anywhere you look for a podcast, The Jeweler's View with Courtney Gray. But yeah, just Courtney Gray Arts, and I'm same on Instagram, Facebook, Courtney Gray. I'm at Courtney Gray Arts on both. So follow me, reach out. Yes, please join. If you're not in Austin or Texas, and find out if there's a WJA, the Women Jewelers Association, near you, if there's a chapter near you, and they're popping up everywhere. And if there isn't, you might want to look into starting one, because what a cool opportunity to just connect. And it's not just for women. It's a really old organization. It's been around, I can't remember how long, but they are amazing. They do meetups once a month, and it's a great way to get out of your bubble and go and hang out with other makers of, and even there's, it's not just jewelry makers. There's appraisers, there's retailers. A really a great opportunity, and any chance we can get to connect, right? Symposiums, et cetera, I think are smart. I know it's dark so early. It's like, what's happening? Yeah. It's so weird. I know I don't like driving at night either. Anyway. But yeah, get out. I met you back when you had the store, I think. You had a little store in on. You did. I do. Oh, I remember now. Yes. That was a cool store, y'all. There were beads everywhere. You went in, it was like Candyland for jewelry. It was so cool. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Oh, I love it. I'll make a point to do that. Swimming in beads. Yeah. I love it. I love it. It's called The Jeweler's View. Yeah. It's really for mover shakers, makers like you. Like, how do we just connect once a week? It's like a pep talk from Courtney once a week, you know? And then I'll be bringing in experts again as well, and not just in jewelry, but in business, so that we can combine those two efforts and start really making things happen, making moves. So that's the goal, is just to support for everybody. And thank you. We are tribe sisters. Same to you. I don't like calling people a resource, but I call myself, like, use me as a resource, because that's what I'm here to be. And if you have questions about things, I'm not necessarily teaching how to solder anymore. I feel like there's so many people who are so much better at that, who are doing that. I'm more on the back end, the jewelry business end. So, and the mindset, you know, that it takes to make it through for 25 years plus. So, it's not always easy, and there's curveballs. So definitely, I'm here as a resource, and I know that you are too, Sugar. What a great thing that you're doing for the industry. We had so many students. It was 20, over 25,000 students came through, and it was like, there's no way. I used to know every student, and, you know, by name, and even have their phone number in my cell phone, you know. And then it grew to this bigger thing, and it was faces, and names were difficult. So I feel you on that. But we're doing the best we can. Sometimes, yeah, sometimes they do. And it is, yeah, thank you. Even though it's gigantic now and populated, it's still our sweet small town in a way. So yeah. Yeah. It was like Southwest Houston, like Westhorpe and Derry Ashford. I don't know if you know that area. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You weren't that far. Yeah. Houston's big. It's so big. Yeah. There's a lot of different pockets, but. Oh, yeah. Or hit some museums. There are some really good galleries and museums there. Yeah. Austin needs a little more of that, in my opinion, but yeah. Sounds good.